We're joined now by Jim Hendry, Special Assignment Scout for the Yankees. Jim, you join us every year, and every year we talk about how great your farm system is. Yeah. Yankees have always been highly rated, but you've had to deal a few of your top prospects. Justice Sheffield recently comes to mind for Paxton. Where are you still feeling about where you are in the organization, what kind of depth you have?
Well, the whole plan is really has come to fruition pretty well. I think the last 4 or 5 years under Damon's direction, who you just had up here, we went from, maybe in the bottom third of the game up into the upper echelon in our system. Tremendous job by him and our amateur staff, Donnie Rowland, and our international staff, but we're the New York Yankees. I mean, you get to a point where a main reason why you accumulate so many assets is, in this environment, we're here for one reason and one reason alone, and that's to win championships. So you're going to need as many assets and many prospects you can to make certain deals. I don't think it's any secret we're so fortunate now to have made that deal for Paxton, the way the free agent pitching market's going and where those dollars were going, that it's a way bigger deal today, I think, even than it was a month ago, when we made it. So, we've given away some guys, and not every trade is a boom. Sometimes you have some that don't work out, but I still think our system is, you can listen to the magazines and the Baseball Americas, and they've got us down in the middle of the pack, but we have a whole lot of people in the lower levels and some great arms coming. We've got people that threw as well or as better than Severino did when he was a young kid. So we think we've got a handful of huge pitching prospects. They're not household names. We probably won't give out those names today if we need to make some other trades. But, we still have a huge collection of people. Like, really, nobody talked about Andujar 3 years ago.
Yeah.
We feel like we've still got a real good surplus and have a lot of faith, obviously, in Damon and his staff and Donnie and his to keep that pipeline coming. We've proven that we don't – Judge was the 32nd or 33rd pick of the country. The other night people said, Damon, you got a tough job this year. You're picking 30. We'll get a hell of a player 30. I can promise you that. Just like we did when Judge was 32 or 3. So it's all part of it. Hopefully we'll make another trade or two before either this – offseason's over during the deadline, it puts us a chance to be world champs again.
I'm glad you talked about trades because you've had so many titles in your career, including being a GM. Brian Cashman once said to me that he's got to ignore all the noise that's surrounding everything. How do you stay disciplined when you're in that room? And there's probably an urgency to make a move, but you want to make sure it's the right move.
Yeah, you know what we have, and this is all credit to Brian, we have a tremendous variety of people in our inner circle. We have Cash has done this job tremendously for 20 years. You got great baseball people like Tim Nehring and Jay Darnell. We got some rising stars coming up, the Matt Ferries of the world, and Kevin Reese, our farm director, Danny Geis, and Matt Daly, the pro scouting directors, and a tremendous analytic department. We don't always agree. It's a very healthy environment. You hash things around, you agree, you disagree. And what Cash does as well as anybody I've ever seen is he ties a whole lot of different kind of people together and in the end usually makes a real good decision. So it's very healthy. It's very, open-ended, open-minded. And when we hit the streets, everybody's on the same page the way it should be.
You know what, Jim, you're a great guy to ask about this, but why are things happening so slowly at this winter meetings? You have so much experience as a general manager making deals. Is it because of what you're saying? There are just so many opinions in these organizations now. It's tough to get everybody on the same page to make some deals.
Well, I think the game's changed. We all know that. And a lot of it for the positives. A lot of it is, we can all debate how the collection of talent now is maybe different than it used to be. I think we're going through an environment where there's a lot of great young arms, high velocity arms. I think a lot of clubs feel maybe the depth of great hitting prospects you don't have in the game like we used to. That maybe start at the lower level, travel ball, the NCAA rules are different. We're not getting as many great athletes as we should play in our game because of lack of scholarships. So over 15 or 20 years, it goes in a cycle that we're not getting the same great athlete consistency. So I think what happens now is when you have a good young hitter, or a great young hitter, you see a lot more guys tied up earlier, like even 2, 3, 4 years before they hit free agency. Yeah. So the people that are available, the depth of offensive type people aren't what maybe it used to be. Maybe arms are, maybe relievers are, but quality major league hitters, those guys, when somebody knows they've got one, you want to hold on to them as long as you can. well before you would have in the old days.
Jim, you mentioned some of the personalities that are in that suite discussing different deals. Can you kind of take us through the process on how you go about it and how you do get everyone to agree on one player?
Yeah, well, like I said, Brian just has a unique way. He's so good at, like, everybody speaks their mind without the roof ever getting raised and without him tipping his hand all the time. And he'll test your conviction. He'll take a statement that you make and he'll challenge you on it a little later on in the day. And you know, if you want to pound the desk for somebody, you better stay with that same conviction. And it's also a healthy environment that, look, you know, people call the Nearings and Hendrys and Darnells the old school guys. You know, we've come a long way too in learning from the younger people things that we didn't understand or know. And I'd like to think that 7 years later, after I was a GM, I'm better now in my overall repertoire from learning from some of the guys that I knew nothing about the world there. And I think they treat Tim and Jay and I the same way, that, you know, we might be old fossils to them in some ways, but they also, they lean on us for some experience that they don't have too.
I think you can still outrun them in some ways.
There's no I could not run them when I was 20.
Hey, final quick question, because it dawned on me when you said the word conviction. It's easy to pick out the kid who's 6'6",
right,
pitcher, throw it through a brick wall, but have you ever tried to sell a guy and been successful? Maybe a finesse guy, maybe, hey, I think we need to take another look at this kid.
Sure, absolutely. You know, at the end of the day, you want people to win baseball games for you, and not everybody does it the same way. And there's different ways to skin a cat. If you're only going to evaluate players by how you use a radar gun or how you check the home run column, you're not going to win championships. It takes a variety of people, a full roster, a full different kind of people. It takes winning type players that aren't necessarily the most talented. You know, Brett Cardner had a tremendous career. You know, he was a great senior signed by Damon, but he wasn't this phenomenal, tooled-up guy that everybody in the country loved. You win baseball games, you win rings with people like that, and every ball club's going to have four or five guys that don't fit the mold of high prospect, high tool guy. They're just winners.
All right, Jim, great stuff, as always.